I'll ramble some more.
No, I mean, I guess we can just start. They may not know who we are.
We're gonna start now?
Yeah.
Okay, we're starting.
Let's first introduce ourselves.
Hold on, wait, there's somebody else coming in. Here we go, come on in. Wow.
Because you may not know exactly who we are.
Oh, we're just gonna get to the back.
Yeah, it's cool. You can go.
Come on in.
There's no door.
Come in.
There's no door.
Come in.
You have to be awkward.
We're good.
It's a requirement.
You're a filmmaker. You have to be awkward.
Yeah, so I'm Courtney Sandifer, and I am producer, writer, producer, production designer.
Director.
I directed a lot of my own short films. I produce for a living. I do video production. I'm a writer producer for a small production company in Houston. I'm actually flying to Detroit tomorrow, right after my female filmmaker panel, to go shoot some videos for work in Detroit. And so I make a living doing filmmaking, but not exactly filmmaking. It's storytelling. It's little mini docs. You know, I do some stuff for nonprofits like Habitat for Humanity when they need a video and stuff like that. So those kind of things. But filmmaking, like the movies that we make, we don't really make a living off of those. We do it as a hobby, you know. He's an IT guy by day and horror filmmaker by night.
So let me interject.
Go ahead.
Statement number one. Have a good job. Okay.
Don't quit your day job. Literally, do not quit your day job.
And statement number two, don't dream about somebody coming and paying you $1 million for your movie. That seems like to me that it's like something that's perpetrated by Sundance, having one every few years that blows up. I mean, they're good movies, but it just feels like to me
it's like winning the lottery.
It's
basically
like winning the lottery, but it seems like it's done kind of on purpose to sell the idea that you can do that, you know.
Yeah.
And some people do, and you know what? One of you people sitting in this room could be the one that comes up with something that's just like, why the fuck didn't I think of that? And execute it properly, or properly enough that a production, the big studio can come in and maybe overlay the color and sound and all that stuff like they did with Robert Rodriguez's first movie. You know, they sell that as he made this for $7,000, but what really took was a great movie made for $7,000 and then fixed up by a movie studio for who knows how much, probably $100. I don't know the numbers, but that's what happens. And then you throw a bunch of money and hype behind it and boom, you know. Then we're sitting here wishing we could do that, but maybe it's just that we're not skilled enough or we don't have a popping idea, you know. But
they have great ideas.
I love making movies, and I don't care about the money, you know. Yeah. But anyway,
tell them who you are. Like, what movies have we made?
Chuck, Norfolk. Okay, so we.
Do you want me to introduce you?
Sure.
He's an IT guy. So Chuck started writing like 20 years ago. He started screenwriting and going to film festivals and learning how to write, and like started submitting his films for competitions. You got one into the finals of the Nichols Fellowship thingy.
No,
Project Greenlight. Also, the original Project Greenlight. He got into some like final rounds of that.
With the script, not with the movie. So yeah.
But and then we met like 10 years ago. You know, working on short films in Houston. We just, you know, started working on little things on the weekends and stuff like that. And
she showed up without her wedding ring one time, and I said, sup?
Yeah. So we fell in love on a short film. Some crappy short films that we worked on. But he had this stack of scripts, like 15 finished screenplays, and I read through them all. And we decided in 2011... We worked on the movie Jacob together, which showed here like 10 years ago. We were both like assistant directors, and that was my first like big movie to work on, and it was so much work. It was basically how not to make a movie.
Right. It was a, and that's
So I got my education like really fast, thrown into the fire, and I still, you know, I have degrees in things. I've got like a master's in public administration, but that helps me in some of the project management side of filmmaking.
But what about me though?
But we learned filmmaking by doing.
Right.
So we worked on Jacob, and then we decided to make Haunted Trailer with Ron Jeremy in it. In my
suburban house.
Yeah.
Built into sets to look like
a trailer.
Trailer.
Which I realized later looked like my dad's house, and I didn't do it on purpose. I like looked around one day, I was like, oh, I hope my dad doesn't see this. I built his trailer home in his house.
Right.
But we made it for like, you know, like $12,000 or something. It was really, and like half of it was Ron Jeremy, getting him to Houston.
And come for one day and shoot him on yeah. green screen, and he plays a demon, so we superimpose him and found a great special effects guy that hadn't done that many movies and was a friend of ours, and he did it for free, and it's, to me, it was amazing that he did what he did.
Yeah, and he works with Tom, DWN Productions. He's got like the masks over in front of our table.
Yeah, if you
check him out.
Mask guy.
He did some masks in the Haunted Trailer too.
But what about me?
So he wrote a Haunted Trailer, and we produced that, and then, you know, we finished that, and that was fun, and we're like, okay,
survived.
What's didn't next? Yeah, we didn't murder each other, or we stayed together, which is great, still crazy to me.
Yeah.
We're still together, but it's the only time we ever fight. Like, well, not only time. Driving.
It's the same thing, driving.
Yeah.
Women should never be in charge of either of those. They're having a female
filmmaker panel tomorrow with Catalina.
There's Catalina right there.
So we made Getting Schooled Next, which was another one. It's set in 1983. It was like flashback to his high school years, and it's like The Breakfast Club meets a slasher movie. Really like crazy. The killer's in a wheelchair, and it's ridiculous. But it was really fun. And
we screened it here with about 400 people watching, which was amazing to me.
Yeah, Haunted Trailer had a huge room full of people. Has anybody seen Haunted Trailer? Yeah, one lone. Yeah.
Poor soul.
I apologize. and then we got through that one and got a little bit more distribution on it. And then, you know, we worked on friends' films too. I did a lot of production design, set design on other people's movies. And then the third, you wrote Conjoined.
Right, but statement number two, stopping there, is work on other people's movies. Because you'll learn a shitload of what to do and a ultra shit load of how not to do it. Or how I wouldn't, you know, you wouldn't do it.
How you
know?
Wouldn't do it.
You put
favors in. You help other people on. So you're learning from their and their mistakes, but you're also putting in your time in their movie.
You.
So when you make yours, then people come out and they're like, hey, I want to help, you know? We've had people that just kind of come out of nowhere and like want to make a movie, and we're like, we don't know you. We don't know if we should invest our time in you, you know? So you kind of have to get out there and network and build up. And that's what Chuck did. Chuck's very good about. He would go and like boom off on somebody's movie.
Yeah, and that's the worst job on a set. But there's people that, I don't know whether they like it or not, but they're great at it. And I've made friends and gave people opportunities in earlier films or worked with them on other sets. So we're friends, and they know I'm not a dick. Well, I mean, you know, I'm not gonna make you work 20 hour day. You know, I don't like wasting people's. That's another thing. Don't waste people's time when you, especially if people are working for free or low salaries. Don't waste their time. Have a call time. That I know I'm all over the place, but
it's okay. I'm gonna get us back on track. In a minute.
Okay, but you know, as far as that, just how you want to be treated, right? When you show up, when you're saying, hey, I'm going to come work for you for $50 for 10 hours. Mm. You know, I want to send them home in 8 hours, you know, or whatever, you know. have food for them, have drink for them, you know.
Water.
Yeah.
How are you guys doing? Questions at the end or just whatever?
Yeah, yeah. You got a question?
Well, I was just curious because you guys are a team. What if you're doing it on your own? When do you know when to step away from directing and be a producer and vice versa?
Yeah, it's a good question. You've never had to do that.
I'm not skilled at that.
No, but you are. You do. We both produce. Like we, especially he's more on post production. He drives the film. Like once shooting is done, I'm like, oh, like so tired. I don't want to do that again. And then he drives it until it's finished. And that's where a lot of producers, so they think that their film is made once you're done shooting. But like, man, there's so much work in post production.
And that's another thing. Finish.
Yeah.
If it's a piece of shit. No, really, I'm serious. It takes a lot of people to make a movie. If you shoot it and bring people to do it, have a screening. If it's crap, you know what? The people that are involved in it will love it and remember doing it, and you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And you know what? Even if it's a crappy movie, actors or crew or, you know, the guy doing sound could be like, you know, check out the sound on this clip from the movie.
Yeah.
You know, that.
They have stuff that they're real.
Or yeah, actors have real stuff that they can use, cinematographers, things like that, even if they're beginner. That's how you begin. So make sure that you finish. I think in Houston, I'm known as, Courtney are the ones that finish movies.
Yeah.
So when you go and ask for money, like on a Indiegogo or something like that, they know they're gonna have a DVD or Blu-ray coming to them of a completed and, you know, pretty coherent movie. You know? I mean, sometimes but they're gonna be, you know, they're gonna get something. They're gonna see it. It's not, hey, give me some money and then it just disappears. I know you guys have probably given to campaigns where it's just, you know, doesn't work. But anyway.
So how do we not waste people's time? You start with a good script. And even if it's not a good script, it could at least be formatted properly and, like, you know, in shape enough that it's a blueprint for your production. And so if you have a good script, you think the story is great and everything, get it formatted properly so that one page is about 1 minute of screen time. And then when you're planning your shoot, you know, like, I can shoot 3 pages in this amount of time, and you're shooting 3 minutes of the movie. And so your script becomes the blueprint for your production, not just for you as a director, as a, you know, the filmmaker behind the camera, but the people that you're asking to come and join you need to know what they're doing. And so your script is the starting point for that. And you take the script and you break it down. You make the lists
first,
you make your shot lists.
How many pages do you guys think that a script should be for a feature film?
A feature film?
Yeah.
I wanna say more than 100.
Anybody else?
120.
Okay.
120?
Well, okay, so.
I said 1 page a minute, so I kinda gave that away.
My gospel to myself is that right now, as a filmmaker, basically in Hollywood we'd be called no budget, right? Filmmaker, 90 minutes is max for a independent no budget feature, because if you write the 120, which is cool, then just imagine how much better the script's going to be if you get rid of 30 pages. It's going to be popping.
Pacing,
right?
Is good.
You got shorten your dialogue, stuff like that. Just get to the point. And Life Insurance Lottery turned out being 84 minutes.
Yeah.
The script was 90 minutes. Go ahead.
When you make a film, do you do a lot of CGI, or do you do it like old school, like 70s, when you really have to do it?
Go ahead.
What does that do on the time, like
shooting?
Yeah.
Okay, so Haunted Trailer, we did a bunch of CGI, okay, because
I mean, we did a ton. All the blood and effect stuff was.
Oh yeah, we
practical.
We did a, yeah, we did a mix of that, but we did on that. We did do a lot of CGI.
We did.
And the thing is, if you. We're going to answer your question.
Eventually.
CGI, just make sure you have your shit together before you go shoot. And that's going to be something else to touch on. But
whoever's going to do the effects in post-production need to consult with you to make sure you shoot it correctly before you go shoot it. Because otherwise they may get your footage and be like, I can't do anything with this.
In a 90-minute movie, we did a day of green screen with Ron Jeremy.
Yeah.
And that's all it took, you know, so for the whole movie. And he's in the mood throughout the movie, you know.
We did some other green screen too, because we built the inside, like the living room of the trailer was actually in Chuck's, like, he had like a 4-bedroom suburban house.
So when
you're like,
the front door
is literally his foyer, like inside his house. Yeah. So we had like a little window that we
We put a green screen
behind it, so that if anybody comes in or out the door, it's green. And so we thought that was going to be pretty easy, but then we didn't plan. There was like artwork and shit hanging in the house that had green in it.
Right.
So when the green screen guy went and did that, like the stuff on the walls like sizzling, and we didn't plan ahead well enough, and we learned our lesson. So.
It didn't really, I mean, it's in post-production, it's going to take longer to do. I would suggest, but here's the other side of the coin is if you're doing practical effects, blood and gunshots and all that stuff, one take, boom, I kill you, blood splatters back on the wall, you fall down, close up and you dead. Guess what? We screwed it up. Camera wasn't, you know, light wasn't right. You got to clean everybody up, clean up the whole place up.
Yeah.
So it's.
And you have to plan for that.
I'd say
like,
it's
you know,
yeah.
It's not going to happen perfectly the first time. Right. So you have to like be able to reset, you know, and like if for getting schooled, it's a slasher movie. So like people are getting different injuries and somebody dies and then they hug the person and it's blood on their clothes and. Like, so we actually had to plan out, like, where each injury was going to happen on their body and their clothes. And you don't shoot it in order. Like, so we had two actors from L.A. that we had to shoot at the beginning and, like, shoot them out. So we're, like, skipping all through the movie. And so we had to plan out, like, okay.
She had blood maps of the characters, where they were injured, where their clothes had stains.
Yeah. So in scene 35, he gets stabbed here, you know, and so... There's actually a different shirt. There's like a stab shirt and a non-stab shirt. And so you have to like keep up with that and make sure that you put the stab shirt on when they're supposed to be stabbed and stuff. So like that's where the whole planning ahead thing comes in and breaking down. If your script is formatted properly, then you can actually do a proper breakdown of your script. And there's software to help with that.
Yeah.
Basically, it means going through your script and like tagging anything that needs to be tagged, and then it makes lists of stuff, you know, and breakdown reports, like where the art department gets a list of props and a list of set dressing that they need to go purchase and wardrobe specific things. And then your makeup people know like what scenes the effects are in, and or even like if a girl is crying, sometimes we have to reset just her eye makeup. And so the makeup artist needs to know like, oh, she's gonna be crying in the scene, I need to bring extra stuff or whatever. And so those scenes will take longer to shoot with practical effects on set. But then if you do CGI version of it, it'll take you longer after, you know. But we like doing practical as much as possible. It just looks better, realistic, you know, if we're going for realistic.
In getting schooled, we did somebody gets killed and is... like crucified up on the
bulletin board
that says be cool, stay in school, and her guts are hanging out and her eyes are cut out.
Yeah.
So we didn't have our shit together.
Not all good, right.
So the camera crew was not ready. The makeup person for some reason got the word to put the makeup on her face.
Yeah.
So we have an actress, and this is me. This is, I'm the person that says, do not waste anyone's time on set. She's sitting in that makeup for like an hour waiting for them to get the fucking cameras up.
Can't see. She can barely move. She's
literally
like covered in stuff.
Foam prosthetics on her eyes and a prosthetic on her stomach.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's something post-production.
Yeah.
You have your script. You have it tight. You have it at 90 pages. I know you're going to love a lot of stuff that you've written in there, but, you know, have you guys ever heard the term kill your babies in writing? Okay.
Yeah.
It's hard to do, but it really makes a difference.
Yeah.
For the actors, for everyone, crew, everyone.
In terms of what to cut out and what to keep, a lot of times I wrote down here show, not tell, because I wanted to say that. A lot of new filmmakers think that they have to put some long dialogue
like
a monologue of like their whole life story and like, I'm doing this because of this. But like, usually you don't really have to put that in there. A lot of times your audience is smarter than you think they are. Like, they will pick up on small cues, you know? Trust your actors to like express these emotions in their face. And like, in real life, like, we don't have conversations where I'm like, I'm so mad at you right now because you looked at me weird. Or, you know, you just look at them and you're like, you know.
Yeah.
So make your actors do that. Just make a face, you know, and you cut out all this extra dialogue that you may end up cutting in the end anyway, you know.
We ran these guys off.
No.
You look great, though.
Thank you.
That's awesome. But yeah, show, not tell. That comes in the script writing. And then when you get on set, if you have to cut things, cut the dialogue. Honestly, like, you know, and like people moving from one place to another, like a lot of new filmmakers, I just dealt with this a few weekends ago helping my friend on her short film, and like she felt like she had to follow them from this scene. She's like, oh, but we have to see them move from this room to that room. And I'm like, no, it's movie magic. Just cut to the next scene. Like, you just cut and they're in a different place.
Transitions.
Like, in your head, you assume that they walked over there, you know? So cut the things that are really not necessary and make a compromise. Filmmaking is literally all about compromise.
It sounds a lot like writing books.
And fixing things.
Yep. It's a storytelling thing. Yeah. Like, what is essential? What does the audience have to know and have to see in this to make it happen?
Independent directors, their job is fixing problems the whole time. No matter how ready you are. You're still having to do that.
You will be asked questions all day, every day. Like, the director comes on set and people ask questions. You need to have an answer and you need to be decisive.
You need to know what you want, right?
If you don't know, if you haven't planned ahead and like know the answer to these questions, or at least can't come up with an answer on the spot, it'll drag the whole production. And people just end up waiting while you sit and contemplate like how I want to do this. You know, think about it ahead of time, get it down, get your shot list down. I actually wrote down storyboard. A lot of people skip that part.
I don't storyboard.
He doesn't storyboard. He's not really a drawer either. But like, I like to, when I'm talking to my cinematographer, explain what I see in my head. And a lot of people don't know how to do that, you know? Chuck trusts the cinematographer more. He has like a really good symbiotic relationship with the cinematographer most of the time. So if, you know, he has Ron Green shooting and Ron says, I think I want to set the camera up here, Chuck's like, yeah, that's good, you know? But I have a very specific like thing where I want to shoot, and I draw it so that they understand like the head is over here and this is in the distance. Just stick people, you know? Because a lot of directors have that. They're visionary. They want to see the scene a
certain
way.
Are you saying I'm not visionary?
Yeah. But you do that with some of your scenes. But a lot of times it's like, it's a dialogue scene. Just get a wide shot and two close-ups of the people talking.
If it doesn't serve the story, don't do. You know, if there's, it's fun to have some movement now and then. But if it's not telling the story or helping to tell the story, don't.
Just set the camera up and get the scene.
On sticks, shoot it, you know?
Yeah.
But there's some movement. I mean, if you have a little rig like a telephone rig like that, You can do some of that, but cell phone, whatever.
Yeah, I like handheld a lot, and he just calls it shaky cam.
Yeah.
But I like handheld and like move. I like a lot of movement, and he doesn't. So that's a director's choice.
Right.
And so just because you want to shoot it a certain way doesn't mean your cinematographer automatically knows how you want to do it. So that's why that storyboarding and making a shot list and talking to them ahead of time before you step on set, that reduces the wasting of time.
Well, then they need to know what the equipment they need.
Right.
But the really what a lot of we're talking about right now, I mean, since the beginning of this rambling is how much does it cost to sit down with a spreadsheet and figure out how long pieces of your script are going to take to shoot, how long, what equipment you need, how many actors you need in this scene, what actors you need.
You need extras.
When you need them, when you need them together, so how you can make that work. How much does that cost to do that if you're sitting there by yourself in your office?
Yeah.
Zero, okay? But as soon as you get on set, and I mean, we're by no means, we don't have big budgets, but every penny counts, and if you have your shit together, you're gonna save a lot of money.
Yep.
You're gonna, you know, pre-production is huge. When I have downtime at work, I will go through and do all that. And there's software and things like that you can use that really help. But, you know, having your wardrobe together, I mean, it's crazy how much stuff goes into it, but you can do that with it before you even start the movie. And you can know every single bit of it.
And then when you step on set, you know what you're going to do, and then you can communicate that to people.
Need.
And then you get it. You know, you don't get on set and then have a conversation for 3 hours. You know.
Right.
You guys are answering my question fully, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Filmmaker is sort of a general term because it's you're usually the director. A lot of times you're the writer. You're producing. I've really never worked on an indie film where the director didn't also produce, you know, because it's your film. Also, no one is going to give a shit about your movie more than you do. Like, nobody is going to care more than you do.
And if you have your shit together, I mean, that's a, like, people are like, damn, they, you know, they want to work for you. And if you're not wasting their time, they want to work for you. And they know that, hey, oh, yeah, I usually make $400 a day on my real production job or at my real job, and or you know, $150, $100, you know, and they'll do it because they know, and bust their ass because they know it's all set up and you know what you want, you know what you need, what equipment, what the wardrobe in Life Insurance Lottery. One character in that movie had as many wardrobe changes as the other, probably every short film and the other two features that I made. Just one person. So if you don't have that together, you're gonna have continuity problems, you know, things like that. But anyway, just make sure everything's planned out, and you can do that for free.
Yeah. The reason why there were so many wardrobe changes and Life Insurance Lottery was because it took place over the course of like several months of this guy's life. And so there's story days. So there's like 30 story days in our movie. But in Getting Schooled, there was one story day.
Yeah.
It all took place in an afternoon, kids in detention, you know? So we had wardrobe changes because of the stab wounds and like, you know, the guy takes his Letterman jacket off, leaves it in the classroom, that kind of stuff. But if you have a lot of story days in your story, you're gonna have more wardrobe to worry about. Like, unless you want your guy to wear the same clothes every day, which that's a thing. Is somebody, oh, they just wear overalls all every day. That saves you a lot of hassle because, you know, they come to set, you know what wardrobe they have on that day. It's always the same thing, you know. So there are certain things like that you kind of pick up. Like, how can I make this easier for me? Because this will be the hard thing, you know. And period films are one of those hard things to do.
I don't know why we do that. But,
yeah. In 1983, you know, it ended up not being as hard as, like, I did a movie that was set in the 90s. It's like an indie, it's not a horror, acid test. And I did wardrobe on it. And it was like 300 lines of a spreadsheet with all the wardrobe that I had to do. And it was all set in like 1994. And so that doesn't seem that bad because it's like, oh, it's not that long ago. But yeah, there's a lot of difference. And not just like your main characters have to look like that. Any extras that you're in, the cars.
Set design.
That are, you know, you can't have a car any later than 1994. Anything before that is fine to be in the scene. But like, you start to think about those things. Like, if they're in a movie theater full of people, are you going to show all those people because they need to look like they were from 1994? If you just want to show the back of their heads, then you're a little safer with that. But like, you have to think about those things ahead of time, and that saves you so much trouble and heartache when you do all of that planning ahead. But it's another reason why we suggest doing a short film, actually multiple short films, before you try to make a feature.
I think I did 12 before I did it. And the good thing about doing like film contests, you guys have any of those where you live?
We do the short film, the fake trailer competition here. So have y'all done the fake trailer before? When Billy started it, it was his idea. But we did it 2 years in a row, I think.
And that's a good way. And you know what? If you do know somebody who actually is a pro, and you say, hey, I'm doing a weekend shoot, you know, we're friends.
We need you for one day. That you can get, like, way more expensive people to come and help you if it's just, like, one day. Or just spend the weekend with us.
And then you build trust with them. And you know whether they're somebody you can work with, right? So those film competitions are great. You know, 48 hours slamming a movie out. None of them are great. Well, mine were pretty great. No. But, you know, you kind of find those people in your community that you can work with and trust. And then you can also create trust with them by, on a 48 hour, it's kind of hard, but having your crowd together and not wasting their time and feeding them.
Stuff. And if they suck, they're only there for 2 days and you're not stuck
right,
with them.
Right, exactly. You never have to see them again. And that happens a lot, but you do pick up, you know, a full crew, basically.
Yeah. And some people you just don't work well with them. Like, they may be great, mm-hmm. and then they come and you don't match up very well on set.
Are there any actors in the room?
Actors.
Oh, sorry, dude. Okay. Are you a method actor? Okay. Method actors. Chapter 2000. Yeah, it's a nightmare. So it's totally not necessary. People can act, and you can basically, my rule is just, you know, learn the lines, say the lines. You know, I picked you because you fit this character, right? And that's another thing.
Yeah. You trust them ahead of time. You work with them ahead of time. Like, I don't like to spend too much time, like, talking and, like, pumping up my actors, unless it's for a very specific thing. But, like, spend some time with ahead of time. They understand the character. They know who this person is. And they come on set, and they do their thing. Just let them do their thing. And if they miss a few words, who cares? Like, they have that they're in that emotional space. They're doing their thing. We don't nitpick over words unless it's something specific that has to be in the movie.
Right, and that's another thing. Say the lines. Also, my other thing I say is this is not Shakespeare. So you do not. I'm not Quentin Tarantino. I'm not going to make you do 50. Takes, and you know, because of my lines, get the gist of it. I mean, there's some stuff that I write that I think is cool, and I'm like, okay, say this.
Yeah, or something that like nobody would say in 1983.
Right. Or in Life Insurance Lottery is what I was thinking of, but you know, most of the stuff. But good actors are going to say your lines. And if they, you know, if they miss something, don't beat into the ground. Just move on. You know, if it's a good take, if the emotion was there and stuff, just deal with it that way. But
We do give our actors space separated from the crew a little bit too, though, which is another part of the planning ahead. Like, if you're shooting in the living room of this house, where are you going to set up makeup? Where are people going to go to the bathroom? Where are people going to park? You know, there are things that a lot of people don't think of until they get there. And my friend that is new at it, you know, we shot at her house, and I was like, is there parking? Luckily, she had like a little empty lot that was across the street. We got really lucky with parking, but like he's had.
On the other hand, when you do a 48-hour film festival wherever, or film thing, where your entire crew's working for free for, you know, sometimes you do work long, like 12-hour days, you know. And they parked in your neighborhood parking lot, unbeknownst to me, has a sign up that they're going to be towed, and the entire cast and crew got their frickin' cars towed. And guess who had to pay for that? Me.
Yeah.
So, yeah, if, and that, you know, that's a good way to learn, though, when you have only 10 people or 8 people, as opposed to a 20-person crew, you know?
So, that was before he met me, by the way. I think ahead. Most of the time. Yeah, like asking people for locations, that's always a really hard thing to do when you need a specific place. We actually suggest being more open than you think. Like, if you think, oh, this has to take place at a gas station, and that's actually kind of a hard location to get because they're open. They don't want you to shut down their business. And then we had a scene, we were helping our friend shoot a scene in a gas station. They agreed for us to shoot there, but they didn't want to close it.
It was a robbery.
It was a fake robbery. It was a comedy even.
In a open gas station.
In the middle of the day. And so not only did we have to worry about, like, you know, people coming in, but like people seeing through the window that there's a masked guy with a gun up.
Lesson three. Alert the police in the area.
Yeah.
If you are going to have any kind of guns, any fighting, yep.
Fake,
anything.
Comedy, whatever. Because from a distance, you don't know. And like we had this happen on Jacob in shooting in Richmond. It was the middle of the night. And like, you know, the guy in the movie, the guy, like, you know, they think he killed his stepdad and his little sister or something. And like
a mob
of rednecks get together.
Pull up in a truck and they're in this
and they're like all shotguns and all this stuff and like, you know, they're gonna go out and run off and find the guy. Well, the police had no idea what we were doing,
like,
and somebody called.
Four police cars come hauling ass up,
their hearts racing, and like, oh my god, we were this close, you know. And like that was what I said, like, we learned so much on that film.
How not to do
that. Yeah. Because you don't want to have that situation. You don't know what's gonna happen. Like, you can't blame them for being freaked out, you know? I would have been freaked out too.
I mean, somebody could have got shot.
I realized later how terrible that was. Like, you know, wasn't my job to think about.
And it's better if you're working cheap for somebody. I was free on that, right? Yeah.
Yeah,
I worked
for paid money to work on that.
Yeah. So, but you know what? I learned so much on that movie.
Work on somebody else's movie first. Go
Many
find
movies.
Other people and go learn your lessons and stuff. But the short films, we suggested making a short film first. And we also suggest making a short film. So 10 pages or less, usually. Something that you can shoot in a weekend. You know, if you can shoot it in 1 day, 2 days, then you can plan everything. You can schedule everybody, get focus on these 2 days of shooting, and then you're done, you know, after that weekend. My friend just made a short film that's like 20 more pages long, and that's two weekends.
I told you.
It's too long. It's too long for a starter, because it's two whole weekends, and then if something goes wrong, one actor's not available, then you're like, okay, that's the next weekend, and you're like, oh, then the other actor's not available that weekend, and then it takes you like 3 months to make a short film. Because of scheduling. And scheduling is really the hardest part. But if you have a cast of two people, main characters, it's not a big deal. But if you've got like an ensemble, getting schooled with like five teenagers and then the teacher were the main ones,
And then the janitor.
Yeah, the janitor, Ron Jeremy, we shot him in a completely separate day. And, you know, those five people, towards the end of the movie, there's not many of them left. But in the beginning, they're all there, and they all have to be in one place at one time. And it's a lot harder than it sounds to get your schedule together. Because the director has to be there. He's off
every
other weekend.
Did you learn anything? No. See you later.
He's off every other weekend. So if we're shooting on weekends, it's only every other weekend. Or he has to take a weekend off.
And I work night shifts, so we shoot at night too.
People have kids. They have to have childcare. You know, like, it's school schedules and things. Like, we had teenagers. We have finals. We had to deal with finals 1 year on something. Right. So scheduling is the hardest part, and if you start with something you can shoot in 1 or 2 days, then you know you'll be finished, and then you just edit it and you have a finished product.
And if it's not exactly what you expected when you shot it, finish it.
Yeah.
Okay? Finish your edit, clean up the sound, put some music in, make sure you give everybody credit at the end.
And it never will be exactly like you planned. It never will be.
I mean,
there's going to be little things that
everyone says that, you know, things are imperfect. Jaws, which is a fucking masterpiece in my opinion.
Yeah, and it ends up being better than you thought it was going to. Like, there's a mistake. You think it's like a disaster when it happens, and then later you're like, oh man, that was actually pretty cool.
Hold on, I can cut that scene. And guess what? It didn't make a fucking difference.
Yeah.
But.
Why horror? Why you decided to do horror?
Why horror?
I think it grabs more people, and like with Frightmare, you have an instant spot to, well, not instant, but you know, a better chance of screening, and there's a lot of horror film festivals. If you do a decent movie, you can get in, stuff like that. You can get distribution with that, even with low budget horror. People probably like yourselves understand it's like its own genre, right?
Exactly.
You can if it's screwed up, something stupid, you know, something dumb happens or something, which it usually does, but something I mean that just happens in the production, people will laugh at it, right?
Yeah.
You know, you have a prosthetic fall off somebody's face, it'll kill.
Leave it
you
in.
Know? Yeah. Depends, you know, but are that.
Work it in.
Right. Everybody know what? But no. But it's we understand as fans of no budget horror understand kind of constraints that people are working under. You know, actors that are pretty green, maybe crew that's green, maybe the sound's not that great or the picture, but it's still kind of compelling and fun to watch.
Yeah.
Like, what was that? The preacher thing? The dinosaur preacher?
Velocipaster. Yes.
Right?
That was last Frightmare. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and that guy got huge heat on that. He was in, like, Variety magazine and all kinds of stuff. And, it, you know... Didn't you have like cut scenes where I didn't even see it, but I heard so much about it that he had cut scenes that, you know, in there that, okay, car crash, that's all it says or something like that.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. And like, I think a lot of horror filmmakers that we don't take ourselves seriously, like we don't, not too seriously anyway. Like we know, like, you know what? This is fun for us. Like, a movie, to me, is supposed to be fun. Like, it's supposed to be entertaining. If you want to make a drama, which I have, I made tearjerker short films and stuff like that. But, like, you got to get into Sundance, you know? Like, the competition is just way different. And, like, horror movies, there's, like, niche horror and niche this and, you know.
Right.
Comedy has a little bit of that, but comedy is also, like, really wide open,
and
too.
You have to be good to do a full-on comedy. I mean, Haunted Trailer was a comedy, but it was really stupid. Like, super low bar, you know?
Yeah. It was literally funny, because on set, we were like, you know what? If it doesn't work, we'll just put some duct tape on it. And that's literally what we did. Like, if something fell apart, we just slapped some duct tape on it, and it worked, you know? Like,
yeah.
And it was literally full of shit. Like, there's different kinds of shit in the movie. That, like, we got creative. Like, one I made with a Tootsie Roll. We made chocolate pudding. We made different, like, textures of shit. Like, put corn in one. You know? But, like, that kind of, like, you guys get that. You know? Like, you get it, what we're trying to do. And, like, he's in a shot of conjoined, which they made for conjoined for like $2,000. Joe literally was like, Chuck, let's make this for like nothing.
Yeah.
And there's a shot where he's in the background of it and they just slipped it in on purpose, you know? Continuity went out the window. It's just, nobody pays attention to that, you know?
Or if they do, it's funny because you know this is a super, it's conjoined. It's about a conjoined sisters. One of them falls in love in an online dating site, comes to marry this guy with her sister attached.
Which he didn't know.
Who happens to be a serial killer.
Just the one, so, not both of them.
Okay, so you know that you're in, and where's the?
Oh, we got a copy
and
of
it. Here's the cover. Is basically, you know what you're getting with this right here. You can pass it around if you want to. But that matters too. Cover art, making it, you know this is going to be a cheese fest. It's.
So, the question.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
For people who are low budget right now, is there anything that we have out kind of that's in stores and stuff like ring lights and things like that you would recommend?
A Chinese lantern, you know what those, what are they called? Ball?
China ball. Yeah.
Yeah. And with a dimmer switch, because you could place that, like if you're going to do a close up, you just put it like you want the light here or behind you.
It's basically a soft light.
It's a soft
That's
light.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And it is great.
Yeah.
Also, if you want, I mean, in conjoined, we knew somebody who had a studio, and he said, we made friends with this guy because we worked on movies for him.
Yeah.
He let us use the studio, which had three walls, like you would see in a play, and some furniture in there.
Flat. It was like set.
Big windows.
Set,
and stuff.
Like fake
so,
walls.
But then we had lights. Let's say we have lights here and here, and we don't want to have to move the camera around a bunch, so we just leave our lights. We didn't want to work lights, so we just move the wall back a little bit, and then set them here, and then there's your light, right? So it just depends what type of situation you're working in, but that's how you do it cheap, because you don't have to have grips or people moving lights or anything. The lights are there, you move the walls, you know? I think there were like four of us working on it, and then some good actors.
Also, if you're in the horror, make friends with people who have haunted houses.
Haunted houses, yeah. Haunted Billy.
Houses, you can go from there.
Right.
Yeah, Billy had been making, you know, his haunt for years, like been making costumes and props and stuff like that. And those guys, there's a big haunted house. They don't do it anymore in Houston, but some of those guys.
I worked with Kingwood Asylum. I helped build a lot of their sets, and it's just like a real place.
Well, the great thing is you can get, I mean, you know, I don't like zombie movies, but if you're making a zombie movie, you got a built-in cast, right?
Yeah.
You have people that know how to do makeup already on themselves sometimes, things like that. Do you guys want to take some questions?
I have to pee. Sorry. The beer like literally went straight through me, so I'll be right back.
Where are you guys located in the mall?
What's that? We are in Enterprise Room.
You're like the second row over near Billy. Sorry, in the back, McDermott.